everyone. It's 1 p.m. Eastern, and that means it's time to begin our 88th CoCoRaHS WxTalk Webinar. A very warm welcome to all of you joining us today. I'm your host, meteorologist Henry Regis. Running the technical side of our program is our very own Noah Newman. We're coming to you live from the Colorado Climate Center here in foggy Fort Collins, Colorado. All of our WxTalk webinars are sponsored by the generous donations of listeners just like you. Well, for today's webinar, we invite back an old friend of ours who was one of our co-presenters on our very first WxTalk webinar back in December 2011. Wow, that's 12 years ago. And yes, that was on snow. So our very special guest today is none other than New Jersey State Climatologist and New Jersey CoCoRaHS Co-State Coordinator, Dave Robinson. Dave is a professor at Rutgers University in their geography department. Dave's awards and accomplishments comprise a list way too long for this broadcast. So let's just say you're getting a top-notch scientist who knows his subject very, very well. Dave is a lifelong resident of New Jersey. He's an Eagle Scout. He's a New York Yankees and New York Giants fan. And I bet he has loved snow since he was a kid. So let's give a big CoCoRaHS welcome back to our good old friend, Dave Robinson. Dave, it's great to have you with us today.
Thank you, Henry. It's the old that got me there a little bit, but yeah, long time. How about that?
Well, long time. Did I say old? I meant to say
you
long.
You said time. Old twice, but who's counting?
Tell us, how did you get interested in weather? Was there a single event when you were young? What got you interested in that and snow?
You know, if you want to figure out my age, the first week of kindergarten, Hurricane Donna came up the East Coast and affected New Jersey. I remember that well. And it was followed by one of the snowier winters on record, which was followed by New Jersey's snowiest 20th century decade on record. So, I don't know what it was, but I, like many of you listening in here, professional or just avocationally, it's something you go trace back to your childhood. And with fond memories, I've been keeping weather records since fourth grade. Just a wonderful lifetime opportunity to just explore the weather and the climate and get paid for it, too, in recent decades.
You know, I remember growing up on Long Island, and we would, as a kid, snow was in the forecast, and you go to bed at night, and you couldn't wait, and you wake up that next morning, and it was rain, and a lot of times we'd be right on that border, being on the coast, and so, but those snowy days that we did have, they were wonderful.
Absolutely, there's nothing to transform the environment and such, and you know, over in Jersey, we had a little more snow cover than Long Island. You people know Louis Ussolini, the former director of the Weather Service, who grew up on Long Island as well, who loves snowstorms. And here I'm on the other side of New York City, with a little more snow cover. And that's what I've researched outside of my state climate duties and other academic duties. I've been a snowman back throughout my entire research career, back to graduate school.
Well, Dave, it's great to have you back with us today. There you go. And we'll let you take it from here.
Let me share screen. You tell me if anything's coming in wrong. And off we go.
Looks good.
Okay. Again, thank you for the kind welcome. Great to have so many people that I understand we're going to tune in today. I hope I provide a little enjoyment, a little reminiscence sometimes in the next 45 minutes, and then we'll take some questions. There's always something to talk about with the weather. We all know that. There's something to talk about in the snow world. Now, here in New Jersey, the southern part of the state had a record low snow last winter. Some places barely saw a flake, but we could still talk about it. Up north, it was the seventh least snowy winter, going back to 1895. But again, we can always talk about it, and we can look elsewhere. And that's the wonder of today, where, you know, Henry was talking about following a snowstorm up the coast. And the worst sound I could hear was the rat-tat-tat of the sleet, meaning the snow was turning over eventually to rain. But I would listen with my transistor radio in my bed and try to pick up a station down in Baltimore. And if it was still snowing in Baltimore, there was a chance that it was going to snow all night up in Jersey and, you know, might not have school. It didn't matter to me. It was just, it was snowing. So how things have changed and the access we have to all this information, and the access we have to each other. And that's the wonderful thing about CoCoRaHS. And how we can exchange not only data, but friendships as well. And certainly this mutual interest in our weather. So anyway, the picture on the right there is from the snowy Route 80 corridor over the Sierras last winter, taken by the former state climatologist of Nevada, Steph McAfee. So we'll start off there. Greetings from New Jersey, by the way, and Rutgers University, which probably some don't know is the state university of New Jersey. And greetings from the Rutgers Global Snow Lab. Yes, I'm the state climatologist. I could greet you from there, but also this is my snow interest, and we have a global snow lab. You can visit it at snowcover.org. And you can look at, I'll show you a few figures, a few maps we produce on a daily basis. We have tabular data as well. On snow cover across the Northern Hemisphere, back to late 1966 from satellite developed or derived products. Going backwards here. Why snow? We talked about how we love the quiet and the way it changes the environment and all. But it's more than that. It's a water reservoir, and you folks out west certainly know that, even more so than us in the east. It's a water reservoir globally, huge, at least a third of the world's population, I believe it is, gets their water from snow, melting glaciers, melting snow cover and such. So it's an important water reservoir. It influences weather and climate. We'll talk about that a little bit going on. It'd certainly be dangerous. You notice the title here was an avalanche of data, but snow is dangerous, but whether it's an avalanche or for transportation circumstances and beyond, as we learned tragically last December in Buffalo with their major localized blizzard. It's important for wildlife. It insulates the ground below and allows for better hibernation for animals and safety for plants. But it can also be a problem if you get a deep snow and it's crusted with freezing rain. It can make it very difficult for animals to move through that environment. So there's a danger there. And of course, it's fun. It's fun to play in. It wasn't so great for downhill skiers last year out in the Sierras, as you can see on the right, where the chair, so much snow, the chairlifts were buried. But it certainly is fun to play in as well. Getting back to that weather, climate, snow connection, pose it to you folks. Did it snow because it's cold, or is it cold because it snowed? Well, there's one simple answer to that. Yes. It goes both ways. It has to be cold enough with that moisture to get that snow to fall. But once that snow is on the ground, it can play a major factor, not only in accessibility of water resources, but eventual chilling of the atmosphere, setting up of high pressure systems, deflecting storm tracks, so on and so forth. So the answer really for this question is yes on both accounts. We're going to start looking at snowfall. Then we'll get a little into snow cover. We're going to talk some about snow measurements. We're going to talk about snow and climate change. Going to try to cover the waterfront poor statement there. Over the next 40, 45 minutes. Let's look at snowfall there. My son's former backyard with heavy, heavy, wet snow falling. If you could put sound to this, this was a day in Jersey where I was out on my cross-country skis, not in a forest, down the middle of the streets that were plowed, because all you could hear was like gunshots going off as branches snapped in the nearby woodland. Normal annual snowfall. I love this for a couple of reasons. First of all, it does show you the higher elevations areas in the west getting the most snow, the lake effect areas in the east. But I love the word normal on this one. Put it in purposely, because is there any such thing as a normal snow season? I mean, the variation is huge. When people say, what's the average annual snowfall? I remind them that, you know, for instance, here on campus at our well over century-long cooperative station, the least snowy year was about 3 inches. The most snowy year was 78 inches. We averaged high 20s, basically. But when is it average? But this gives you an idea of the distribution, the latitudinal distribution, except when elevation comes into play and those lake effect areas come into play. This, a little retrospective down memory lane of last winter. First year. That's why I want to put in this year. This is from NOAA's NORISC, National Operational Hydrologic Remote Sensing Center. They put out a daily product on snow accumulation for the season, for the last 6 hours, the last 24 hours, really a wonderful site. And this just shows you where there has been some snow thus far this winter. But as you can see, it's been rather sparse. Northern New England, the Adirondacks, Northern Plains, and of course, out in the Rockies, the Sierras and the Cascades. But not a plentiful season thus far, but this was just 2 days ago, and it's only mid-December. So for those looking forward to more snow, there's plenty of time ahead to look forward to it.
Now, hey, Dave, while you've got this slide up, just a quick thing on NORISC. Folks may not know it, but the snow water equivalent, SWE, 75% of the reports to NORISC on SWE come from CoCoRaHS volunteers. So great job, everybody out there, on getting those reports in. Very valuable to that organization in NOAA.
Yeah. There's nothing like the SWE data. The Weather Service here uses it all the time. There's really nothing in terms of SWE anywhere in New Jersey except for CoCoRaHS folks. So it's incredibly useful. So there we are this year. There we were last year. And you can see the northern tier did well, but not so good from the mid-latitudes down. A very sparse snow season. There we go. This shows you the snow blitzes that hit the Great Lakes in November and December. And you can see, you know, for instance, here, this is Buffalo. When you look at the lake effect off of Erie and Ontario, it wasn't extensive throughout the season, but it was just so persistent in one area. It didn't budge. And that's what it made it. And it was brutally cold in the December event, which made it so and so deadly. These are some shots were taken. Some of these photos, I can't remember if both made it into WeatherWise magazine snow story for the year, which I've had the privilege of writing for almost 15 years, I guess, in WeatherWise. The magazine started by one of my idols, David Ludlam, who I was just blessed to know in the last 15 or so years of his life, which ended at the end of the 90s, who I grew up with WeatherWise magazine. So it was just a pleasure to know him. And it's an honor that he started writing these annual snow reports in the mid 50s for WeatherWise, and that I am now the one doing it is just, it's like the cherry on the sundae of a snow career. So there we go with that. Look at this. This is a webinar. This isn't a serious class here. So there's your lake effect snow. You'll see a few more. I'm not nearly as goofy as your host, Henry, but we'll have some fun here. This shows you the general progression of storms as they came across the country last year. They started in the west and, oh, there's the Sierras getting snow. Then they got hung out in the Rockies and the Great Basin for a couple days. And then they started heading along the northern tier of states into the Dakotas and then into Minnesota and northern Wisconsin and the upper P as they went across. And then they snuck into the northern New York and into New England. But notice all parts south kept missing out time and time again. Now, this was probably the biggest southern-ish, as I say, track of the entire season last year. It didn't come up the East Coast. It was a typical La Nina storm track up through the Ohio Valley with the snow to the northern side of the path. And you could see at least some of the lower plains caught in with a little snow with that particular system. This was a fast mover that came across the country, and you can see how it zipped across late February. And then towards the end of the season, I call it the bookends, you had again snow out west in the mountains out west, but you had the biggest event of the season hitting up the Hudson Valley and into southern New England, where they had multiple feet of snow from that event. And then finally, one of the last places, the last place you usually go to look for snow in the east late in the season, but even compared to west, and at least there's an observation here at a little over 6,000 feet, this is the summit of Mount Washington, New Hampshire, where they you can see a rather pretty ample June snowfall. Okay, so what about this winter? I've been asked this question, I don't know how many times. I can think of a couple yesterday. I can think of this morning when I was at something with our Cooperative Extension annual conference. What's this winter going to be like? What's the snow going to be? Well, this is an El Nino year. It's a moderate to borderline major El Nino at this point. Generally, the storm track is along the southern tier and up the East Coast. And this is born by looking at moderate to strong El Ninos. This was put out by NOAA a couple weeks ago. The areas in brown have below average snowfall during an El Nino, a strong El Nino winter. And this is January to March, I might add. So they just broke this small period. But down along the East Coast and down in the southern the Sierras and into the southern Rockies and mountains of Arizona, you can see above normal snowfall. Now, in North Carolina, Virginia, you know, Delmarva, it doesn't take a lot of snow to go above normal. You can have one major storm. And that's often the case with an El Nino winter in the east. It's kind of feast or famine. You can get that one big dump of snow and the rest of the winter relatively benign. But that one storm can be a blockbuster if the cold air is in place when that coastal storm comes up the coast. We saw that in 1983, 2016, 2010, but we were shut out in a major El Nino in 1998. Couldn't put that cold air and moisture together. So that's the story there. Is this a prediction? No. This is a climatologic analysis that allows you to perhaps make a projection of where the snow may go. This is looking at it a little more in detail. Just saw this about a week ago from Weather Underground. And it basically says, yeah, you'll get more snow here in the coastal mid-Atlantic Northeast than in the inland Northeast when you have an El Nino as opposed to a La Nina and even normal. But what really makes the difference, as all of we snow freaks in the East know, is what's this, the North Atlantic oscillation signal. So the light blue is when you've got a negative NAO and you've got an El Nino going on. And you can see there will increase your potential of getting heavy snowfall. So it's not all about El Nino, but when you combine it with El Nino and the Northern Oscillation, even the inland areas for the most part, except up in Maine, get more snow. So we'll see. And we know the NAO can't be projected far ahead. It's an atmospheric signal. So we'll just have to keep looking at that index as we go into the heart of winter. So that's your snowfall. Now let's look at snow cover. My favorite use of a golf course is demonstrated right here with my cross-country ski tracks. This is something that you can visit. The URL is below. It's part of our office's cooperation with the World Meteorologic Program and the cryosphere group within that. We update this weekly. The purple lines, which you keep an eye on, that's what Northern Hemisphere snow cover extent was compared to normal, the dotted line, normal being 67 through 2023. This was the most extensive, not year, but week within the year. So it could be a variety of different years there. And this is the least extensive. And you can see so far this season, snow cover was running above normal. And that was partially due to North American snow cover in November and Eurasian in late October. And then it's dropped the last couple of weeks down to about normal coverage. But that just is a hemisphere-wide value. This is a map from just 2 days ago that shows you in the golden areas on the left is where the ground was snow covered as of 2 days ago. And you might say, well, that's interesting and all, but how does that compare to normal? Well, in our lab, we've produced what I believe is the only daily anomaly maps available internationally. And the areas in red on the map on the right should normally have snow cover on the 12th of December and don't this year. The areas in blue should not, based on that long-term average, but they do. So you can see North America is really low snow cover-wise right now. And it vacillates back and forth in Eurasia. You can see a heaviest area here in Europe where they had some heavy snow a week or two ago. But it's not very extensive positive anomaly and some over in Northeast China. But right now, looking at North America, it's slim pickings. When Edmonton doesn't have snow cover and you're into the middle of December, that's unusual. This, I want to bring you back to last spring, and you'll see my point in a moment. This is May snow cover averaged over the entire month. And the areas in blue had full snow cover. And you can see this is based on percentages of the time in the month of May it was snow covered. The previous ones you were looking at, it's either binary, snow or no snow. But this is looking averaged over the entire month. And the brown shows you where there were departures. Snow cover for the month was below normal. So Canada, snow cover left early. And May was mostly devoid of snow. Why is that important? I think there are a number of you already reading my mind here. That had to do with temperature. Ah, I got you so far, but we'll go on. Temperatures were above normal. So this is the one, was there snow? Was there lack of snow because it was warm, or was it warm because there was a lack of snow? And again, it was a little bit of both, but certainly due to the fact that the early loss of snow with its high reflectivity, with the energy needed to melt snow, instead warming up the snow-free ground, there's no question that it was a matter of both playing a role there. Sure, a high pressure ridge built in there, that helped to melt the snow, but once it was off to the races, the lack of snow itself contributed to the warmth. And with that, the moisture, the water of that from the snowpack was gone early, and the heat increased evaporation early. And what happened then? Fire, just a remarkable fire season in Canada last year, as you all know. And with ramifications here in Jersey, I do a top 10 of the year for New Jersey, weather and climate. Smoke from Canadian fires is going to be number one this year, highlighted by the June 7th case where it was the street lights were on in the middle of the day on a clear, otherwise clear cloud day from the smoke from the Canadian fires. And many places suffered worse than that during the course of the spring and summer. So there's a tie. My point is, there's a tie-in with snow cover, or the lack thereof, and the desiccation of the woodlands in Canada over the spring, the ignition of fire, and the ramifications throughout North America following that. Let's look at the long-term trends of snow cover. This is just quickly summing up the seasons going back in the 70s, 80s, 90s, up till the end of this last decade. The green bars, we'll go to there first. That's spring snow coverage. And you can see it has steadily declined. Winter in blue has really picked up a little bit in extent. But what's also very interesting is fall. Autumn snow cover has actually increased in coverage. And you may be left scratching your head there going, well, the Earth's getting warmer. How are we having more snow cover in the fall? And I've worked with some scientists. They've done the bulk of the work, a group in Canada, and we've looked at this, and more work needs to be done. But it appears that this is a circulation pattern that is dropping cold air into the northern middle continents, up in the Arctic, subarctic, in the fall. Okay, that could be there, but you need the moisture. And there's more open Arctic Ocean from sea ice melt, contributing more of a moisture source. And then the circulation is bringing from the south more moisture into these areas. So not where we live is getting that snow in the fall, but the northern continents, and particularly the middle part of the northern continents, are getting more snow in the fall. So again, work in progress. And that's what's exciting about this. There's always something that continue to interest and mystify. But what does this speak for the future? Are we going to keep getting more snow in the fall? Is spring snow going to keep declining to the point where the decline isn't going to be too evident because it's going to be gone by the early part of spring? So anyway, let's look at, get past this very vocal protest and see a couple of studies. This one only goes back, this needs to be updated. I should get to it, or it's from the EPA. Change in snow, snowfall. And you can see along the southern limb, there's been less snowfall. There's less snowfall up in the Pacific Northwest from the 30s into the earlier part of this century. And a mixed picture, but you can start to see a little more blue than red as you get into the northern Midwest and northern plains. Could it be that you're getting more moisture into those regions that are starved for moisture during most of the cold season, and that's producing some more snow? Then there was this interesting study that came out a couple of years ago comparing the last two normal periods. So essentially what we're doing here is taking away snowfall, from the 80s and inserting it from the teens in its place. So you're just changing your 30-year periods, and you see a very pronounced decline from the 80s until the last decade in snow in the south. And there's that increase in snow up to the in the northern plains. I think this is a climate change signal from all I've seen, all I've looked at, as suggesting that with time, that yellows and oranges and reds will creep northwards, but you're still going to sustain snowfall due to the fact that it's still below zero. But as you get closer to zero, approach zero, the freezing point, the CoCoRaHS relationship suggests you have the potential of holding more moisture in your atmosphere, which can produce more snow. So it's not as simple as some people think. And we'll see. Now, with time, things will catch up and you'll keep the temperature above freezing. And with that, you're going to lose your potential of getting snows. But until that time, we're going to still be producing snow, perhaps more in the higher latitudes and still on occasion in the middle latitudes. But with that, we're going to start seeing more rain than snow. Now, these next couple of figures are tricky because they're saying we're getting more of our precipitation as in this case, in the red areas, as rain rather than snow. But you have to also factor in, are they getting more precipitation? So you can get the same amount of snow, but you can have more precipitation falling as rain if you get more precipitation in general. So there's a couple of things to factor out here. So there needs to be, again, more study and more keep a close eye on this, because this came out just a couple weeks ago. I saw this graphic. You see, it's attributed to CNN. And this one I'll just throw out to you folks here because I got to think about this more, to be honest with you. I haven't had enough time yet, but it sort of makes sense that more of the precipitation is falling. And this is from the 70s until recently, just now, that Ohio Valley and points north and south getting more of their precipitation as rain than snow. And you can see that along the southern tier as well. But up here in the Pacific Northwest and up along the Atlantic coast, more of your precipitation is falling as snow. We're not getting more snow, but we're getting more of, when you melt it all down, we're getting more that falls and melts down as liquid in snow than rain. I got to think about that some. I can tell you here in New Jersey, we have not had much of a change in snowfall, actually a little bit more on average over the last 30 years than the previous 30 years. And we are seeing, and you know, big snows are still uncommon enough that you have to be very patient as a climatologist to get a sense of things. But we have gotten a number of major snowstorms. So that raises the question, as we've seen with precipitation here in the Northeast, but across most of the country as well, kind of my old, when it rains, it pours. We're getting more of our precipitation in large events. Some places aren't getting more, but what falls is falling in larger events. Others are getting more precip and it's falling more in large events. And I think that's what we may be seeing with snowstorms along the East Coast now, the last decade or two, and we'll see how far into the future, that when it snows, it dumps, you might say. And we'll see about that. But an interesting figure I decided to put in for a point of discussion and thought and discussion. Got to have a little fun again. Now measuring snow. Now I'm not going to give you, I mean, when we do our CoCoRaHS training, we spend 3/4 of our time on how to measure snow than how to measure precipitation. Obviously not the case for you people listening from Florida, but there is a science and an art to measuring snow. There's no question about that. It's more difficult. There's just more difficult. And it takes time. It takes more time to make these observations than measuring, going out and looking in your gauge and emptying out the moisture. You're going to measure the water content of the snow. You're going to try to measure the depth of the snow, of new snow. You're going to try to measure the depth of snow on the ground and maybe even the entire water content of the snow on the ground. It is tricky. Go online. You can Google National Weather Service snow measurement guidelines. I have twice with the grandfather, the godfather of CoCoRaHS, Nolan Doskin. We have both sat on panels in the late 90s and a little over a decade ago, formed by the National Weather Service to update the guidelines on snow measurements. And it's 75 pages. And you might say, you know, that's bedtime reading because you're going to fall asleep real quick. But you guys, you folks, ladies and gentlemen listening to this talk, just might find it interesting. And I will tell you right up front, it involves coming up with the criteria for measuring of snow involved, forget just the science and the art, involved compromise, because there's no perfect way of doing it, or there's 100 different ways of doing it. But the idea is to get consistency and comparability across the landscape. And that's why I believe it's important to try your best to follow these measurement guidelines. And there's some wonderful guidelines in CoCoRaHS training materials as well. There's only one difference between the two, the major difference, and that is CoCoRaHS allows you to measure snow on the ground to, I guess, the 10th of an inch, and the Weather Service only to the full inch. And if you ever look at my observations from Somerset 92 in New Jersey, you'll never see 10th of an inch snow on the ground, not snowfall, not new snowfall, snow on the ground. That's my only battle I've had with your wonderful CoCoRaHS leaders over the years. But anyway, I'm getting ahead of myself. Four measurements: depth of new snow, liquid equivalent of that new snow. If that's all you have time to do, you know, great. Please get out there and do it. If you don't have time to measure the liquid equivalent, don't use a 10-to-1 ratio. Just leave it not available. Then, near and dear to me, but not near and dear to many observers, including this history of cooperative observing in the country. Many people, once the snowfall is over, they, you know, put their ruler away until the next snowfall. But being someone who has studied snow cover their entire career and looked at millions of records and satellite images, we're interested in the not only the new snow on the ground, but any new and old snow, and then getting the equivalent of that. I know CoCoRaHS asks you on Mondays to get the equivalent of snow. If you can do it more often, all the better. But thank you for those who do make the effort to measure the full snow on the ground and the water equivalent. There's not many tools. People say, oh, measure snow. Get a ruler, go stick it in the ground. Now, you folks all know it's not nearly as simple as that. It'd be great to have your gauge. Rain gauges are a horrible means of catching snowfall, except sometimes it's the only way when you have mixed precipitation. But if you have a full snow event, by all means, take a core of the snow on your snowboard. That's going to give you a much more accurate measurement of the water content of the snowpack than hoping it collects within your 4-inch diameter tube. And for that matter, it might pour out of it if we have more than 10 or 12 inches of snow. Where to measure? There's Nolan. Again, I'll just remind you a few of these things. Have your snow ruler, do it to the 10th of an inch, not to the quarter or the 8th of an inch. So if you don't have a ruler that goes to the 10th of an inch, try to estimate that. A level place, you know, sighting is so important, where to measure it. Not under the trees, someplace out in the open, someplace that hasn't been experiencing strong winds. If there's been a lot of wind, you're going to have to do a snow transect, take a series of measurements and average them together. Like I said, I'm not going to get into all the gory details here. Many of you know this and are well experienced in doing it. My ruler was straight there. It is a little bit off kilter there. But to me, I just look at this. That was my backyard. I can't remember the storm in the early first, sometime in the first decade of this century. A nice 18-inch snowfall in a wooded, surrounded by wooded. So that was a nice part of the backyard there. When, this is the other key. Don't wait until your normal 6 a.m., 7 a.m., 8 a.m. observation time. Snow will start settling. Snow turns to sleet and rain sometimes. It warms up, snow melts. And this is where a little of the art and the science come in. But try to make your snow measurement for that 24-hour period ending at your ob time, the deepest snow on your snowboard or in your transect during that 24-hour period. And there are little nuances there I won't leave you with, but if it's 2 in the morning, you're not going to necessarily be up. Try to look out the window at least till you get to bed, because it could turn to rain overnight and then it'll be gone by morning. So if you don't know, just put NA. There's nothing wrong with that. You might get the liquid equivalent in your gauge. That could be very useful in that case. But if you can make an estimate, we're not asking people to become insomniacs when it comes to measuring snow, but try to get it at its major depth before it starts settling, before it starts melting, and so on. But notice I said, during the 24-hour period, the deepest period. And this is where we get into board clearing. And there's been a lot of debate about that. But the latest Weather Service requirements and what they talk about in CoCoRaHS, but in the Weather Service, unless asked to, and that's generally at airports, you don't clear your snowboard during the 24-hour period. The requirements in the late 90s permitted that, much to the chagrin of those on the committee. Our recommendation was overridden, shall we just say politely. But we got it in the last one. People aren't going to be out there clearing their snowboard every 6 hours or more frequently. Yes, you could say, but the snow settled. Well, remember I talked earlier about compromise and the need to compromise and compare between areas. So don't clear your snowboards during the course of the day. It should be your deepest during the course of the day. So we'll just leave it at that for now. If you have some questions about that later, we could talk. I want to give a real shout out here to CoCoRaHS. I haven't done it enough because a lot of what I've talked about is with satellites or with long-term cooperative data. But a huge shout out to CoCoRaHS. Here in New Jersey, if we have someplace through a spotter, through co-op, through CoCoRaHS, measure 2 inches or more of snowfall during an event, we then go collect all the data we can for that event, even if it's less than 2 inches at most places. We make maps, which helps with quality control, and we break it down by county and stations within the counties. And we designate, as you can see here, look at all the CoCoRaHS observations. And that's just for 4 of New Jersey's 21 counties from this event. This was our last big snow event 2 years ago. It was mostly on February 1st, plus or minus some hours. But with the CoCoRaHS observations, we had it for this period. And you can see, this doesn't even show you all the observations we had because we couldn't put them all on the map and be able to see the numbers. We had well over 200, might have been 250 observations that went onto this map just from New Jersey. And these are CoCoRaHS observers in surrounding states. But we only color code New Jersey. But you can see it was a very deep snowfall. And I'll tell you what it helped to do. The emergency management headquarters contacted me. And I should give big credit here to Matt Gerbush, the assistant state climatologist, my co-COCO coordinator here in Jersey, who does a magnificent job of quality controlling the data. He'll write numerous observers, not to scold, to essentially educate, but oftentimes just to ask a question. Did you make the measurement yesterday afternoon, or did you wait till this morning to make the measurement? Because it looks a little low. Or did you measure that drift against your garage instead of? But I tell you, for the CoCoRaHS mostly, it's clean. It's spotters from the Weather Service, and no disparagement to the Weather Service that sometimes aren't as clean. But there's still an education process, and we have new observers, CoCoRaHS observers each year. So Matt's our educator. Let me go back here. The emergency management said, we'd like to know the snowfall. So we gave them a report. And because of that report, the northern part of the state got federal support for snow removal. Without these observations, it would have fallen to local communities who were very hard hit by snow removal from this event. So it's just one example of how your cooperation and your contributions are invaluable for declarations like that. And it could be for rain and things too, of course. And your SWE values are used by the local and national flood control groups that are looking at flood potential and such. So thank you very much for those ops. Water equivalent, this shows you how tough it is to do just using your gauge. Take that core if you can. And again, it's difficult. If it turns to rain and you start melting it off your board, yeah, you're not gonna be able to do it, but try to take that core. And these are some of the rules. These can all be found with, the training online. Snow depth, snow on the ground, that's tricky as well. Don't go looking for the snow sitting in the shade. Or, you know, if you don't like snow, don't find the bear patch. This is where you got to use the art here and look around you and estimate, take a transect through your yard or the field next to your community and make a transect and get an average snow depth. try to avoid the bare areas, try to avoid the deepest drifts and get an idea of what the snow cover is. Now, the other tricky part is once the ground is 50%, less than 50% snow covered, less than 50%, it's a trace. I don't care if there's 5 inches in part of your yard. If less than half of the ground is snow covered, it's a trace. But what if it's about 50-50? Average, zero, and the 2 inches you measured where there was snow, and you get the 1 inch. But that 50% mark is important because you may see snow there, but it's not considered measurable once half or more than half of the ground is snow-free. You call it a trace. So, quick quiz. What's the snow depth here? That is correct, 2 feet. We move on. Finishing up here. We got a white Christmas this year. So funny, I was talking to my wife about that yesterday or something, saying, oh boy, I've just looked at the maps. I've looked at 6 to 10 to 8 to 14 day temp outlook and precip outlook. I said, well, much of this country's not gonna have a white Christmas this year. And the next thing I do, I go upstairs and see that Matt Capucci, I'm sorry, I'm butchering his last name, in the Capital Weather Gang in the Washington Post, I just published an article about that. So if you can get that online, he'll talk about, you know, it doesn't look prospective for a white Christmas across most of the nation this year, but that's on average based on a NOAA study, the probability of having a white Christmas. That's not going to be the case this year, it looks. And then literally last night, one of my colleagues from NCEI sent me this, texted me this figure, and I loved it. I said, I have to show this. So it's not even on the slide deck I sent to Henry and Noah for this today in case my slides failed. But isn't this perfect? Your age, it starts snowing. We're all kids again. We're all kids again. We all love it. And with that, snowman world. I said it didn't snow in Jersey last year. So where did my wife and I go over the holidays? We went to the Arctic Circle. This is outside of Rovaniemi, Finland, literally within feet of the Arctic Circle. And there was this one exhibit at Santa Land called Snowman World. So there I am in Snowman World. There's my name again, my email contact. And again, happy holidays to you and think snow.
Thanks, Dave. Really appreciate that. It's good to look at all those, that data. And yeah, again, our age does drop when we start to see that snow falling outside. I guess until we start shoveling it, then we realize our age when we're out there. But hey, we've got a couple questions if you got some time coming in right now. And here's Shelley was wondering, why aren't measurements of snow taken in metric units? She says if she finds it far easier metric devices than in tenths of an inch. What's your thoughts on that?
I wish they were. They are globally. And when I publish in scientific literature, it's all metric units. But of course, you're taking US data and converting it to funny looking metric numbers as you do the conversion. I don't disagree with you at all. I would love to have seen the US follow most of the world, and those who might be in from, you might be in Canada asking me this question actually. And CoCoRaHS does have the ability to show or enter in both, as I'm sure Henry, I know it's for it's gotta be for snow, not just rain, right, Henry?
Right. Okay, yeah. Here's one from Mr. Woods from Cincinnati. He's a longtime Bengals fan, and he says, you look and sound a lot like Chris Collinsworth of Sunday Night Football. He wants to know, do you have a side job on the weekends?
Yeah, if I did, I might not be here. I might be retired on some island somewhere or whatever. And of course, you set that one up, Henry.
You never know. Here's one from Marlena, and she says, does the albedo effect factor into snow melt? So what about that?
Absolutely, Arlene. That's a great question. And it's one that's been studied as we see dust blowing off the southwest. And I've been up in Rocky Mountain National Park with Henry and seen the red tinge to the snow. There's soot in the snow sometimes in the Arctic and such. And that's going to lower your albedo somewhat. The albedo can vary. And for those who don't know, that's the reflectivity. A fresh snowpack can have an albedo of 0.8 to 0.9, meaning only 10 to 20% of the incoming solar radiation is absorbed by at the surface there. And once it starts melting, so this brings in your climate change a little bit, when it melts, it'll immediately fall 5 or 10% in a day's time, and it won't rebound. Once it starts going down, it will go down until freshened with a new snow. And then you throw some soot on it and some dust on it, and that will lower it, and that will hasten its melt. So that's interesting to look to the future. As we get snow on the ground in a warmer climate, it's liable to melt faster because it's going to start metamorphosing sooner, and that's going to hasten its melt. So really interesting thoughts there.
Jackie writes, and she's interested, should my measurements be restricted to my property or should I go wider than that?
That's another great question. There's no set answer. It depends what your property is, of course. If you've got a nearby field, by all means, go out into that field. If your property is heavily vegetated, a lot of trees in it, you may not be able to get not only good snowfall measurements, but good snow on the ground measurements. I tend to look around my neighborhood. And when I see it less than half covered with snow, whether my shaded part of the community is snow covered still, I'll start calling it a trace. I think satellite, will the satellite be able to see that snow cover, a visible satellite imagery be able to see that snow cover? But everyone's going to do it differently. And again, that's part of the beauty of CoCoRaHS and the number of observers we have, that it helps you get multiple perspectives on this, and it helps you get a baseline idea of just how much snow is hanging around. So you don't have to be restricted to your yard, depending on the characteristics of your yard.
Yeah, Jordan has a similar question or something in the same genre is this. My station home is in the backyard, which is north facing, so the snow stays on the ground longer. My front yard south facing melts pretty quickly. Both yards are close to the same size. Should I be reporting a trace of snowpack on the ground once my front yard melts, or should I be making that measurement on my backyard? So
by the rules, less than half of your yard snow covered, so it should be trace. But again, I would do the community rule there, or the neighborhood rule, let's call it. Look around your neighborhood and see how the open areas look within your neighborhood. The school down the block, the athletic field by the school or something like that, a natural surface of some sort, as if mowed lawns are natural surfaces. But you know what I mean, not parking lots or a tennis court or something. So there's you got to use your best judgment on that one. That's where you folks are bringing in your expertise and your seat of the pants feel.
Susan in Indiana says, it seems that there's a warm core in Indiana around Indianapolis that holds down precipitation. Is the amount of pavement and buildings holding heat something that causes this, or is she imagining this type of thing?
No, you're very right in the sense that you were talking heat islands, which will impact the ability of it to snow and certainly for that snow to be retained. Now, mind you, that includes rooftops melting from the warmth of the buildings, plowing of parking lots and roadways, which hasten not only the melt, but also the warming, because you're exposing, don't have that bright white snow on the ground there. So you do get these holes. Now, is it going to affect overall precipitation? That gets into other questions and an interesting one, because there hasn't been a lot done on urban effects on precip during the winter season. more so the warmer seasons. But as far as snowfall, you're going to see less in the cities because of an urban effect. And in terms of retaining snow on the ground, there's going to be a much shorter period of time. And you can see that if you look at satellite imagery after a snow event. And I've done this, say, in the Front Range. You go and look at satellite imagery, WorldView from NASA, or even your NOAA satellites. You can pick out Denver and Boulder, Fort Collins, and Colorado Springs pretty quickly after a snowstorm, because there'll be this grayish hue to those areas, as opposed to the white of the adjacent fields and, of course, the mountains to the west. So Indianapolis would be a great example of that, with no mountains to influence the characteristics of the cover.
Eric from New Hampshire wants to know, are there studies around showing snow melt rate versus dew point? With dew points above freezing, water vapor condenses on snow and helps melt it, and also creates the misnamed snow eating fog. What do you have to think? What do you have to say about that?
There have been studies on that, and that's a wonderful question. You can melt a lot of snow with a high dew point and winds to bring that moist air down to the surface, and no precipitation falling. A classic example of that was the snowmelt following the blizzard of 1996, when within 12 hours, one of the largest snowmelt events in eastern US and southeast Canada occurred and was followed by rain. So there was some disastrous flooding. But you got temperatures up 15 degrees Celsius with dew points of 15 degrees C, and the winds were howling. And it wasn't a Chinook, which is very different off of the Front Range of the Rockies. But this was all just due to high dew points, high temperatures, and a wind blowing. And it just ate that snowpack up.
Angie writes, and she says, do you have any thoughts on weighing snow? What do you think about that?
I think it's great. In fact, I have a scale. And when I get my water equivalent of snow, I don't melt it down. I weigh it because it's faster. But I'm not saying everyone has to go out there. I mean, I have a relatively inexpensive scale. And of course, I've calibrated it with the snow just to make sure it's correct. And with the weight of the gauge itself and such. So I'm the nerd who has done the tests on that. But yeah, I mean, weighing it is just as good as if you have the right way of translating it into a depth of the liquid precip. It's faster than doing it, and probably just as accurate, because you're not having to keep melting and pouring depending on what the water content is, than doing it through a meltdown.
So Deborah writes, and she is wondering if we measure snow depth on our boards when we guess the snow has achieved its maximum depth, do we also core for SWE at that time? Is that something, is that the time to do it?
Not if it's still snowing. And you might say, well, it's still snowing, it's getting deeper. Not necessarily. It could have gotten warmer and it's a deep snowpack. Or if it changes, I'll tell you what I do. If I see a change over the rain or sleet, I get out there, probably between the hours, anything that's not between the hours of 12 midnight and 6 a.m., but I'll get out any other time I'm available. And I'll take my core then. And then I'll catch the rest of the precipitation in the gauge on my pole. At least I'll add that to it. I'll make sure that gauge is empty. I do have a couple of gauges. My older ones that have gotten cloudy and whatever are used for the snow. Cores and such. So you still want to get the liquid precipitation, whether it's fallen as snow or ice or rain. So it's a little tricky there. But if you think the pack's going to start melting and the water's going to start sliding off your board, get that core and measure it. And then if it's raining now, then add your stand, your actual gauge measurement to it. So again, it takes a little more time. That's what I said earlier. It just takes more time. And if You know, most of you listening in are probably into doing the snow measurements and all, but maybe not. And it's often said in our training and the national training, don't go out and do it if there's any danger to you going down the steps or the conditions are so harsh that you could be put into danger by measuring it. The snow will wait. And if you don't get there on time and you know things have changed before you can make your measurement and it's really can't make an estimate, just put NA. It's okay. There are a lot of us out there, and maybe some of us have gotten those measurements in.
So John, who's one of our CoCoRaHS coordinators and with the National Weather Service in one of their offices, wants to know, what are your thoughts on the SSW, the sudden stratospheric warming events, coupled with ENSO? Does one have more influence over the other for storms to develop snow?
Wow, that's a heavy research question.
I was thinking that, yeah.
A little beyond there. Someone has looked, Judah Cohen, who some people have seen, does a lot with snow estimates, and he tries to look at these sudden stratospheric warmings and all. You might look him up. I've known him since my days before Rutgers and was actually sat on his PhD committee. He's done some with that. I can't even think of a study that's looked at sudden stratospheric warmings and El Niños. They're not related to each other. I would have to say probably El Niño has more of an effect. The stratospheric warmings, we don't know what they're going to translate to in terms of bringing cold shots of air. We know they brought a cold shot of air into Central Asia in the last 2 weeks, where it's been brutally cold, anomalously even so. And they can certainly bring cold air down into the south, as we saw a couple of years ago. And with that could spawn a snowstorm. You know, it brings me back, and this predated me, 1899, the major outbreak of cold where it went down near zero in New Orleans and a huge snowstorm came up the East Coast. Clearly must have been a sudden stratospheric warming a couple of weeks earlier that brought the polar vortex right down into the Gulf states. That's the classic. Obviously, we don't have many measurements, certainly vertically in the atmosphere for that event. But it probably was connected with that. But I don't know if it was an El Nino or La Nina year, whether we could look back into ice cores and figure that out or not. So for now, I just said, I don't know.
Dave, do you have some time for a couple more?
Sure. But I realize some people have to go, and let me thank everyone for tuning in today and let me talk about my favorite thing.
And we'll be taping this too. So if you want to come back and watch the rest of it, if you have to leave, that's fine. So, yeah. Okay. And wants to know, what would you say? Would you say that they've been experiencing a snow drought in the Pacific Northwest in recent winters?
Yeah, for the most part, yeah. I know the Pacific Northwest kind of lost out on last year's major event down to the south. The long-term records show, and you can see the one slide I showed, that's a little outdated now, went into the early part of this century, that the Cascades have lost out. I can't speak for the lower elevations so much. I know Seattle's had a couple snow events in relatively recent years. But yeah, there seems to be a decline in the snowpack out in the mountainous North Pacific Northwest.
And Dave and I hiked out there one time in the middle of July. We saw snow up in the Cascades, if you remember that.
Yep. No, and I've been up part of Rainier, never to the top, but up a ways on a rainy July day, and there was plenty of snow still around, well above Paradise Lodge.
Yi Chan, he writes and he wants to know, how strong is the correlation between average annual snowfall and the size of individual snowstorms that occur? How about the average annual snowfall versus annual snowfall variability?
Great question. My simple answer is that's going to vary from place to place and obviously time to time. The more The less snow you have on average during this during a season, the more it's going to be, the variability is going to be greater in terms of proportionalities. And one storm, as I said earlier, dominating and giving you your annual snowfall in just one event. Now, when you get up to the higher, more frequent snowy areas, in absolute terms, you could go instead of 150 inches in a year, you get 200. And that 50 inch difference is huge. But it's only 25% higher or whatever, 30% higher. Whereas down in the, where snow is less frequent, say in the under 2 or 3 feet a year range, the variability is just tremendous. And it can all depend on one storm. So you can't give a universal answer to a question like that, but it's a good one.
Here's another good one. Cindy writes in and she wants to know, what is the Atlantic Oscillation this year and how often does that change?
That it's a multi-decadal oscillation, AMOC, and it's often been tied into periods, decadal periods of hurricane activity. I've never seen it well tied into snowfall. So I would say it doesn't have a large determining role in snow events, more in terms of tropical events. For the snow, you turn to the aforementioned NAO, the North Atlantic Oscillation, which isn't an oceanographic phenomena. It's up in the atmosphere. You want to dig that trough into eastern North America. And with that, set up your storm track along the coast while allowing cold air to pour down the backside, if you will, of those lows down into the Northeast and Mid-Atlantic. And that's your recipe for a potential snowstorm, which of course can go totally bust if the storm hugs the coast too much. Inland will benefit, the coast will get rain, just goes 100 miles too far out to sea, it might clip Cape Cod, Boston, down East Maine, and miss places to the west. This is where I say I'm real glad to be a climatologist and not a meteorologist, because it's one of the more, and it doesn't just apply to the East Coast. Everyone knows with the storm tracks across the central part of the country, just those 100 miles make all the difference and whether you get totally dumped on or whether, you know, the weather forecasters get cursed out by the snow lovers because it missed.
Dave, you know, I remember up in New England when I was up in the Boston area where they would get the ocean effect or bay effect snow coming in, just like on the lakes. Do you guys ever see that in New Jersey? Do you ever see that along the coast there? Or is it the water too warm for that to happen?
Well, you generally don't get easterly flow. In off the ocean. I've seen some examples of it come down Delaware Bay. And I can think of a case where it might have clipped Cape May, our very southern peninsula of southern Jersey. But otherwise, sometimes you get some remnant lake effect come out off of the Great Lakes and make it down, particularly the hills of northwest Jersey. But off the Atlantic, I can't think of a case. And it's generally because by the time those storms are out to sea, it's northwesterly winds. And as the storm comes up the coast, it could be part of the fetch, part of this moisture characteristics of the storm itself. So we wouldn't necessarily call that an ocean effect. You could say it's ocean enhanced in some respects.
Now, I remember up around Plymouth and then also Orleans area too, getting just, you know, a few miles inland, and boy, it was snowing like crazy. Just these bands lined up, and quite interesting. Okay, we got one more question, right? And we'll finish it up for today. And Steve wants to know, he lives in a windy state, high wind, 40 to 50 mile an hour gusts, 20 sustained after a snowfall where he lives is common. Maybe he lives in Wyoming. I lost the question. Let me see. It just disappeared here. Noah, can we get that back on the screen?
I can make up the question there.
Sorry about that.
Let's see. I was just going through it. Here we go. Okay. So, and the question is, Any suggestions for getting better measurements with that wind?
That's so tough. And I have to admit, I don't have a lot of experience with that. There are enough trees here in the mid-Atlantic. I don't know how you do it sometime, folks. I don't know how you do it out there. A protected backyard, you have a little windbreak around your house, trees to the northwest to help you out or whatever. That's where the art really comes in. And I give you all the credit in the world for that, because I don't know fully how you deal with it. Again, I go back to my thought process of what would you see if you were sitting up in a satellite? Would it look like the whole ground is covered? Okay, that's your starting point. Okay, because it is, well, you don't go into the ditches where there might be a couple of meters of snow. You go to the open area and you use your best judgment. Well, that's tough. That's really tough.
Yeah, I know. In some places in Wyoming, they mount the gauge horizontally because of the wind. it picks it up.
No, they go over to Iowa to find out.
Oh, that's where it winds up. You're right. That's why we have a lot of snow east of some of these places that show up there.
Yeah, that's during the East Coast. The Appalachians block all that snow.
Yeah.
You go skiing in West Virginia because all that snow from the Midwest gets caught there in the Appalachians.
Well, Dave, I want to thank you. A great pleasure to have my good friend here on with us today. And we really appreciate you taking the time. You're a busy guy, but, it's just fun to get together, talk about the snow. A lot of good information, folks. And, I'll try to put some of the links Dave showed us online on the webpage there to follow up with that. So, again, Dave, thanks.
Thank you so much for inviting me. I've listened to many of these as well. It's a thrill to have been on the first one with Noland, I should say. And maybe I'll see everybody again in 12 years.
Yeah, or maybe on Sunday night watching the football games. So, yeah. Well, as we close out today's program, we want to let you know that our next Weather Talk webinar is going to take place on Wednesday, January 17th. So get your calendars out and mark that. And it's one of our annual favorites. Meteorologist Greg Carbon of NOAA's Weather Prediction Center will review the top weather events of 2023. You won't want to miss this one. We currently have registration information, or we'll have it shortly up on our website. So make sure you check on that. And before I forget, when signing off today, there we go. Please take the survey that pops up on your screen. So until we meet again, stay safe, stay warm. This is Henry Regis for the rest of the CoCoRaHS team saying goodbye for now and wishing each of you a wonderful holiday season ahead.